then MATLAB, if you aspire to simulate something like a set of differential equations instead of a transfer function. So it's very common that, just like in MATLAB, we learned you could create an M file that would evaluate the right-hand side of the equations, and therefore you could simulate nonlinear differential equations. You can do the same thing and simulate, but the thing you create is something called an S function. Okay? So we're going to go over this and then go through an example that you guys can work on at the end. Okay, so like I said, they're designed to simulate nonlinear dynamics, in other words, nonlinear differential equations within MATLAB. You can also do linear differential equations, any kind of differential equations you want. Okay. So here's, this is an overview of how they work. Okay, so so you have to write this S function, and MATLAB uses this. So you remember when you simulate and there was a window you could pull down, you could choose a particular integrator. I'll show you again. And that integrator requires that you either have a transfer function specified or that you have an S function specified. And the S function you have to create, it has to do different things. Like it has to either initialize the problem, which means specify the initial conditions, it has to compute the right-hand side of the differential equations, or it has to compute something called the output, which I'll get more into. So the key thing is showing you what this structure looks like. If you need help, there's help all over the place. There's help there, you can hit these links, there's all kinds of help available for anything in MATLAB, including these S functions. So these, S functions look something like this, okay? And I'll give you an example. This is just the overall structure. So as usual, if you want to create one of these for a particular problem, what you do is use one that's created for a different problem and cut and paste to, for your problem. You don't want to start from scratch because you won't remember what it looks like. But so the idea here is that it has these different cases. So what MATLAB or Simulink is going to do is call your S function and ask you to do different things. So you have a case 1 and case 2 and case 0, 1, and 2. So it might be like initialization, evaluate derivatives, calculate the output of the problem, whatever it might be. Okay? And I'll show you exactly what this looks like. So this is the general structure. Okay? And a lot of the cases MATLAB allows you won't use it. Okay, so this case 0, you have to initialize the problem. So if you go back to this, you're going to have the statement here that says K0, and below that you're going to have a set of statements that initialize the problem. Okay. So it, you don't have to worry about this, but it sends a flag called 0, meaning it wants you to run K0. You don't have to worry about that. And then the main thing you need to do here is declare the variables in the problem, like what's the dimension of the different variables, and you also have to specify what the initial condition is. And then you return these things in something called sys. Okay. And so it's almost better if I could show you a little example here. Okay, so here's an example for a problem. I'll come back to what the actual problem means. Okay, so you have this statement that says K0, and it says how many, so number of continuous states, in other words, how many differential equations do you have? Simulink allows you to simulate either continuous differential equations or discrete differential equations. We have no interest in discrete differential equations in this class. So the problem that I'm going to talk about, we have three differential equations, so you specify the number of continuous states to be 3. It has one output, which I'll get into, that we want to do ultimately use for control. So you have a number of outputs, 1. You have one input for this particular problem, you specify that to be 1. And then you have to return this in a vector called sys. That's what it expects. Okay. And so if I remember here, it's a number of continuous states, number of discrete states, which we don't have any, but you still got to put something there, so 0. Number of continuous outputs, number of inputs, and then these are other things you don't use. I forget exactly what they are. I think they have to do with the discrete states that we don't use. Okay. So in other words, and then you specify the initial condition of your problem. Because you have 3 state variables, you need 3 initial conditions. Initial condition for x1, x2, and x3. Okay. So obviously, if you were going to write your own code to solve a different problem, you would just take this thing here, right? Specify the number of states in your problem, the number of outputs for your problem, number of inputs. Use this exact same command and just put your initial conditions here. Then you don't need to worry about what this looks like. Just use this and put your material in there. Okay. So this is the general description. It's kind of hard to follow without the example, so I just jumped ahead. So this is basically problem initialization. How many variables do you have? State variables, input variables, output variables, and what are the initial conditions for the state variables? Yeah, that's what we were doing here. to this K0, which is initialization. Case one, in other words, it sends this flag to your S function, flag one. That means it wants you to evaluate the right-hand side of the differential equations, right? So if we have a set of differential equations that look like this in vector form, right? For the problem I'm going to show you in a second, you have three differential equations, one for x1, x2, and x3. Then you have to evaluate the right-hand side of the equations. It's just like an M file. So you have to evaluate the right-hand side of the first equation, the right-hand side of the second equation, so on and so forth. And then you got to return those derivatives as a vector sys. Okay. So what does that look like? Okay, so for this particular problem, which we'll come back to, okay, this is a bioreactor problem. And so all I've done here is, So what is Simulink giving me? It's giving me the value of the input, okay? It's in the call here. I should have probably started here. So let's just look at this for a second. So here's an example of an S function, okay? It says, I'm calling it bioreactor, for obvious reasons, because it's Simulink. So Simulink is gonna give me the value of time, okay? It's going to give me a value of the x variables, it's going to give me a value of the input, and then it's going to give me this flag thing, okay? Flag tells me which of the things it wants me to do. Does it want me to initialize, does it want to calculate derivatives, does it want to calculate outputs, okay? So what I've done here is specify the parameters of my problem. So we'll come back to what these are, but these are all the kinetic parameters and things for this bioreactor model, okay? Then you have this command, switch flag, and this first command here, or the first case is evaluate the right-hand side of the differential equations. So because I don't want to deal with, I'd rather call U the actual, like U is the dilution rate, which I'd prefer to call D. X1 and X2 and X3 are the state variables of the problem. Rather than write out my equations, the right-hand side of the equation in terms of X1, X2, and X3, I'd rather do it biomass. It's another biomass, as we'll see, for a different cell population. This is just for convenience, not critical. But otherwise, it's hard to see if your equations are right, at least for me. Okay. Then I calculate a couple of functions here, and then eventually, and we're going to go over this in a minute in more detail, you specify the right-hand side of the equation. So that's the right-hand side of the first equation, that's the right-hand side of the second equation, and the third equation. So this is written by a student. He calls this dx dt, and then he assigns that to sys. You could just say sys equals that. The main thing is you have to evaluate the right-hand side of the differential equation if this case is equal to 1. All right, going backwards. Case three is calculate a particular output. So in Simulink, you have inputs, nothing new there. You have state variables, fine. And then you have things that are outputs, which is kind of new, we haven't talked about. But these are the things that ultimately you'll be interested in controlling. So if you have a Simulink simulation, function, then the input goes in, and what you get out of it is y. It's state variables are in here, but you can't see them. Okay. The only things you're going to be able to use in other parts of the simulation, like to do control later in the course, is what you call the outputs to be. Everything else is internal to the S function. You can't use it outside the S function. Okay. So y are the things you want to get out, the outputs you ultimately want to control. Okay. And so that's this flag equal to. So in that case, you just have to evaluate, generally speaking, an output function will look like this. It's some function of the state variables and the input. I'll give you an example in just a second. And you have to specify what those things are. Sometimes the state variable will be just one of the outputs, okay? And you'll see this again via this example, is that, and you have to return these output values in the vector sys again. So either return the specification of the problems in terms of number of variables, if it's 0, if it's 1, you return the right-hand side of the differential equations. If the flag is 3, then you return the output variables. So for this particular problem, you can see that, and we'll get into this in more detail, I have two populations of cells. Call it cell type 1 and cell type 2, and the concentration of cells for this cell type is called X. The variable x1, this one's called y. And the output I'm interested in is the ratio, right? So this is the fraction of total amount of cells that are the type x, okay? So that's the only thing I can use outside the simulation is this y. I can't use x1, x2, or x3, they're not going to be available to me. Okay? So we'll go through this example in some detail. Great, okay, so now that I've explained the example you understand, let's go through the example you will understand. Okay, so this is a set, so this is a system that looks like this. It's exactly the kind of thing you've seen before. So it's a bioreactor system. The only difference, instead of one type of cell growing, we have two types of cell growing, otherwise it's the same. So we're putting in here, so D is the dilution rate, right? Everyone hopefully remembers the dilution rate is the flow into the system divided by the volume of liquid in the system. It's the inverse of the residence time. D is also coming out. Okay. We have some initial substrate concentration, which I call Si. In other words, for these cells to grow, they have to have some nutrients. So this is the concentration of one nutrient that limits our growth. These are the carbon source, like glucose. Okay. And that's the only thing that comes in. And what comes out are cells of type 1, whatever that species is. Its concentration is in grams per liter, let's say, is X. Cell type 2, the concentration is Y. And then you have some residual substrate that wasn't consumed, that's S. And the system is assumed to be well mixed, as usual, right? Okay? Well mixed system. So what I've specified on the board here is the differential equations for the system I've just described. If you forget Y, just pretend like Y is not here, okay? Then there's the differential equation for biomass. I've written that in this class in 361 probably like a dozen times by now. Where did I get that balance equation? Okay. Obviously, x here, if you haven't figured it out, is a vector, and its components are concentration of type cell type 1, concentration of cell type 2, and substrate. Okay. And so this is the right-hand side of the equation. So how did I get these equations? Well, I did a mass balance on the cell type 1, cell type 2, and substrate. Okay. If you just pretend like y is not here, in other words, there's only one type of cell, and its concentration is called x, then you have this equation. Right? This would be d capital X, dt equal that. That's nothing new. I've written that many times. The substrate concentration would look like this. You wouldn't have this term. And this is the same thing we did, like we did the second day of class. This is ds dt would be equal to this. The only different thing now is that instead of one cell type, we have two cell types. And these cell types, you might recall this function here, is how the cells grow as a function of the substrate. And so here would be, usually you call that function mu, and this is S. And so those functions look something like this. Each cell type has its own growth function, okay? You see, so this is the maximum growth rate. That's this value here. This thing is called mu m. And then this Km value, I'm assuming, called Kx, is a function of how quickly it gets from how sensitive it is to the substrate. So if that value is very small, then this curve looks like this. If that value is very large, then this function looks like this. Okay? So this is just common growth functions people use to describe how cells grow in a well-mixed environment. So there's nothing new about that equation. This is the same equation for cell type Y, except we have different parameters, because cell type Y grows differently than cell type X. And then this balance equation for S comes because you feed in substrate, you withdraw substrate at the same flow rate. Cell type 1, or X, consumes the substrate, and so does Y. They each have their own, remember this yield coefficient? It's a measure of how much substrate you consume to produce a certain amount of biomass. All right, so this is just a slight perturbation of problem that I've given you several times before, and now we have two cells growing from a single substrate. Okay, now these cells have to compete for this, right? So you might imagine a situation here. If this cell type grows faster than this cell type, then it just might wipe this cell type out, right? Because this is a continuous reactor, and if this one eats the substrate and grows more efficiently, then this cell type might not live, or vice versa, okay? So we might be interested in a problem like, oh, we'd like to see under what conditions these two cell types can grow together, they can coexist with each other, because we have reason to believe they might not. And so this would be a reasonable output for this particular system. So this is the fraction of x. So we take the concentration of x in grams per liter divided by the total concentration of cells. And so this is the fraction of cells that are in state x, that are type x. So if this is 1/2, that means we've got equal amounts x and y, for example. Okay. If this is 0, it means we don't have any x. And if it's 1, we don't have any y. You probably want to avoid that. Okay, so that's a little example problem. So let's see how I want to do this. So let me show you what this looks like. There's a picture of it. This thing together, okay? And I guess I'm going to allow you to do the same thing. So the question is, how did I do this? Well, it's not hard. You come up here, you go new model, it gives you this blank page. Let's close this one down. Then you have to, in this library, which hopefully exists somewhere, you have to put the things in there. So it looked like I had a step change in there, and that would be under sources. Step, drop that in there. Okay. Then you had a couple of things that you wrote to the workspace so you could later plot them. That's the sync, and those things are called to the workspace, and drop those in there. I just kind of pasted that. All right, so I got two of those. And then now I need to find this S function thing. Okay, so where's the S function at? It is probably under continuous, but I'm not sure about that. Not so much for that. Commonly used blocks. See, this will be no different than the struggle you'll have. No. I'm going to type that in. I'd rather just look arbitrarily. Yeah. Maybe it prefers a little dash in there. This is not as robust as Google. Ah, I found it. But I don't know where I found it at. In any case, there it is. Drop it in there. All right. So now you have this thing. Okay. And so what do? You hook it up like this. Doing it quick and poorly, but whatever. Okay, so I mean that's how you start by putting it together. All right. So rather than continue, let me show you how I. Okay. So this is the same thing. So I dropped these things in the workspace, connected them up. I called this thing D because that's for the input. I want to call that dilution rate. I want to call D, and you have to change this to array again. I call this one R, that's the ratio of the cell types. Again, you have to change that to be an array. I specified this just to be a constant. I guess I didn't put a step in there, I just put a constant. Okay. So this is the constant value of the dilution rate. What I'm interested in studying with this particular simulation is, is there a value of the dilution rate where these two cell types can coexist? Do you understand that conceptually, if these cells are going to grow together and coexist in a continuous culture like this, continuous bioreactor, they're going to have the same growth rate. If they don't have the same growth rate, eventually one cell will outcompete the other one and it'll wipe it out. So what I'm trying to do with this simulation, let's say, is try to find a value of the dilution rate. I hypothesize, I don't know this is true actually, hypothesize there's a value of the dilution rate that'll make the two growth rates equal, and therefore these cells can coexist. Alright? So that may be what I'm interested in studying. Alright, so the key thing is this block here. Okay. So if you see here, I've got this thing, so I created this S function. And the only thing I really have to specify is this thing called bioreactor. So if we hit edit here, okay, you see there's something underlying that called bioreactor.m. You see it? Okay. And what I showed you previously is just, I just cut and pasted from this file, but just to go over it again, you have this at the top, right? You're saying, I'm calling my function bioreactor. Simulink is going to give me a value of time, the state variables, that's a three-dimensional vector, capital X, capital Y, S. Okay. A value of the input U, that's the dilution rate, and this flag, so I know which one of the things I want to do. And I'm to return back cis, you know, and that differs depending on what case I'm going to run, and the initial condition if necessary. I start off, so in other words, let's say you have a problem, yeah.
So is this a MATLAB file that should be in the directory that Simulink has been referencing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, otherwise it would give you an error, for sure. Yeah.
Well, how could, when you're writing functions sometimes, I think that error probably says that it's unused in the file.
Yeah, it says like T is not used.
Yeah, why does it do that?
It's like a warning.
Okay.
It's saying, why would you have something passed to your function you're not using?
Right.
The answer is because it makes me pass it, and I'm not using it.
But you still need to call it in the function. Because
right, if you don't put it in the function, then you're going to get an error because it's going to, the first argument it thinks is time. It's just warning you that you've been passed a variable that you are not using.
Right.
And so just ignore it.
Okay.
Yeah, basically. Because you have to use this format, because that's what it expects. Okay, so if you were to have a problem that differed from this problem, you would just use this file, at least I would. I would change its name to whatever I wanted, heat exchanger.m or whatever. And then I would just redefine all these things, because I don't want to try to memorize what it looks like. So what's the first part? Specify the parameters of the model. Okay, so if we...
The growth functions, you might recall, had two parameters. They had a mu max, maximum growth rate, and then this k value, the saturation. So there's a different value for the x cell type and the y cell type, and I'm just giving you parameters. Okay. They had different yield coefficients. These yields were how much biomass does one get for a given amount of substrate consumed, and I'm using these two values. This is the inlet concentration of this substrate, whatever that might be. And for convenience, I want to call U D because I like the L. I want the equations to have D in them. It'll be easier for me to make sure they look right. Like in principle, you can do this any way you want, but it's better to have D in there. Yeah. He's going to play with my mic for a moment. All right. So that's the first part. This is just for convenience, right? I'm just doing this for convenience. It's a better way to do things because if you decide you'd like to do a simulation and you want to change the maximum growth rate of the cell type X, you just change this one number. Otherwise, you got to trace all the equations this might appear, and it's not a good idea. Okay. All right. So before I put the mic on, so here's this case one. Remember, it's going to ask you to do certain cases. And we already looked at this, but now maybe you'll understand better what I was talking about. So case one is evaluate the right-hand side of the equations. It doesn't matter what order you put these cases in. You just have them all in there. You don't have to put case zero and one. So I've done case one here first. So the first thing I'm going to do for convenience is this. I'm going to specify capital X is the first state variable, capital Y is the second, and S is the third. It's just for convenience. Because I'd rather write the equations in terms of big X, Y, and S than these X, little X subscripts, okay, or components. First thing I do, evaluate the growth function. So this is the growth function for cell type X, and this is for cell type Y.
involves these parameters I specified up above, and in dot involves the substrate concentration. It's just the functions that describe this. The growth is a function of substrate. Okay. Now I calculate the right-hand side of the equation. So I'm assuming you know how this works, but if you, so what I do is I have a bracket here, so I'm creating a vector, and they're separated by, the entries are separated by semicolons, so this is the first right-hand side, this is the second, and this is the third. Okay. So if you look at the equations, this is simply the equations for the first cell type, right? Minus dilution rate times its concentration plus its growth rate times its concentration. It's, okay. Oh, sorry. I'm surprised I have any control at all with this thing. That's cool. Forgot I wasn't in MATLAB. Anyway, you go back, rather than me switching back and forth all the time, if you go back and look at the slides, you'll see those are the right-hand sides of the equations. Okay. And then for reasons that aren't entirely clear, he now has an additional command that says sys equals that, dx dt. You could just put sys right there and just skip this, but it doesn't make any difference. Okay. Just an extra line of code doesn't do anything, doesn't hurt either. Okay. So now you've evaluated the right-hand sides of the equation, that's good. Case three, which he does next, is evaluate the output. So to do that, here's x, here's y, here's the fraction of x that we specify to be the output. This is the coding inefficiency to the maximum. So he calculates r, and then he sets r, y equal to r, and then he sets sys equal to y. You could just put sys right there. Okay, but it doesn't make any difference. So now you've calculated the output for MATLAB. And finally, the case x0 is to initialize. So for this problem, we have three state variables, 1, 2, 3. We have one output called R. We have one input called D. So we specify those numbers. You put it in this vector. These things are always going to be 0 because they have to do with continuous variables our problems don't have. So just use the same command for all your problems to change those numbers. Okay. And then you need some initial condition. So this initial concentration of cell type X, 2.5 grams per liter. This is for Y, 1.5 grams per liter, and this is for S. I think that's a steady state, or can be a steady state, okay? And then there's some other stuff down here that, you know, you can put if you want. I mean, you just probably use this thing as a template, so you probably include it, but this just says, if you call something you shouldn't, I'm returning something, I'm returning nothing to you. And if you do something worse than that, I'm writing an error. If it calls anything but 0, 1, or 3, you're in deep trouble. It should never do that. It thinks your problem's discrete instead of continuous. It shouldn't happen. Okay, so this other stuff's really not all that important. Okay, so with that idea, okay, and so let's see if we can do one final step here, or I've gotten lost. Here we go. Okay, here's this one that I created, right? So in principle, I can click on this thing. I want to actually specify, doesn't it let me specify what it is? Oh, that's not fun. Let's see if it should allow you to click and choose, but maybe it doesn't actually allow that. Was it called this bioreactor? Yeah. Okay, so you see what I just did? You have to manually type in the name there. It'd be better if you could click and then it would give you a window that, you know, like it had all the M files you could choose from, so you don't have to remember the name, but obviously it doesn't. So you have to put that thing in there, type it in. That's the file we just looked at, and then you're good to go. Okay. And so then you will have eventually this thing. Okay. All right. So here's your job. You've got 20 minutes to do your job. Okay. Your job is to create this simulation here. Okay. So how would you do it? Well, since you only have 20 minutes, I would suggest the following. You build this yourself, right? I just did it in like 30 seconds. Drop those blocks in, connect them up. Enter the stuff for that block and that block and that block. And then for this one, because it's a waste of time for you to manually type that, just take it from the slide and cut and paste it into a file called bioreactor.m. Or if you have access to the website, the bioreactor.m, you put that zip file up, Everyone knows what a zip file is, I assume. So we put a zip file with all the examples up. I think it should be there. And if you can unzip that thing, you can find bioreactor.m in there. Unfortunately, you can also find the whole example in there. But it'd probably be useful if you at least put this thing together, right? And then you can select the bioreactor.m you just copy or download from the website or whatever you want to do. Then the goal is to find how the system behaves as a function of D. Okay. So what do you do? You see I have a time set up there at 250 because I know that's long enough. And so what you're going to do is specify a value of D, that's a dilution rate, simulate this thing. Okay. And so let me just give you an example. Let's say I take this value to be 0.5. I simulate it. Come back here. So it's created some stuff, and I plot it, T out versus R. Okay. What happened? Well, so what is R? It's X, the amount of X divided by the total. I have only X, right? So we started off with some amount of each of these two, and pretty quickly the Y is wiped out because the X grows faster, right? So Y, this R going to 1 means there's only X cells left. Okay, well that's not what you're looking for. So you could now try something like this. Whoops. Run it. Plot it. Crap, I wasn't supposed to guess that one. That's the one that works. That's the one you're supposed to find. All right. Let's say you never saw that, okay? I thought I picked it big enough. I'll tell you my reason. Try 0.9. Run it. Plot it. Okay. So now you have the opposite case. You start off with some mixture, and then pretty quickly you end up with only Y, right? Because R is X divided by the total. There's no X left, so it goes to zero. You have only Y cells left. So what do you find? You find if the dilution rate's too small, X grows too fast, and if it's too large, Y grows too fast. So since you've seen this behavior, you might imagine there's some dilution rate in the middle, maybe, where they grow at the same rate. So your goal is to try to find that. So what I'll have you do in the remaining time that you have is see if you can make some progress in putting that thing together. Okay. And the only way you're going to be able to make any progress in the time that we have left is you're going to have to get that M file called bioreactor.m. You can either cut and paste it into a file from the slides, if you have the slides in front of you, or you can download it from the website. So, I posted PDF, right? Can you copy from the PDF and paste it, okay? We'll give it a shot. Because I'm not going to do anything more now, so stand up here. And if you have any problems, then I'll come help you. But you should try to at least start putting this thing together so you get some experience doing it. But don't waste your time manually typing the bioreactor.m. Just go get it from somewhere. And then all you have to do is specify that as the right. Once you have that available, you can just